there's a lot of lessons out there. Like, no, none of that shit is going to make you happy. None of it is. What's going to make you happy is getting to know who you are and getting to accept that, you know what? Hey, when I wrote Have You Lost Your Mind Yet, this album, it was about this. You're feeling depressed? It's okay. I woke up this morning, I felt like shit. That's okay. Now we got somewhere to go. Let's put on some music. Let's feel better. Ooh, Stevie Wonder. Oh man, I feel good now, yeah.
I'm Lily Cornell Silver, and welcome to Mind Wide Open, my mental health focused interview series. Today, I am talking to my friend Xavier DeFrepeles, who goes by the stage name Fantastic Negrito. I met Xavier when he was opening for my dad on tour, so I'm super excited to have him here today, and he's going to talk about his music and his deeply personal lyrics and some of the songs that he's written about mental health. Thank you so much for joining us, and I hope you enjoy.
Hi, Xavier. It's so good to see you.
Man, it's really good to see you. I want to say first that, hey, the world has changed so much since I last saw you.
I know. It's like completely different world, I think.
Well, it's an honor to be here. You know, you're
thank you.
Amazing person, Chris's daughter, and you know, that connection I had with Chris that year and a half was life changing. And I'm really happy to be here with you now.
Me too. I wanted to start just by saying the first time I saw you perform, I think you were touring off of The Last Days of Oakland was the album at the time.
Right.
And I remember walking into the theater during your set and just being so floored and like, holy shit, like this is crazy. Cause you have that that ability to draw people in cause it's like so raw and so real, but also the lyrics, like the music was clearly so personal to you and like very vulnerable to you. So do you feel like music for you like represents, you know, is like part of your soul? Like, is it a mental health coping strategy for you in any way?
Well, first of all, I just want to say that, and I always used to tell people this, hey, Chris Cornell had great taste. I want to say that. I want to say that first. And he put me on before anybody knew anything about me. He told me when I met him that, man, you know, and we saw you on YouTube and we're like, oh man, we just went down the hole. Right. So, absolutely. For me, it's extremely visceral. You know, I'm much more of an artist than I am a musician, I always say. And it's the album that I just wrote, Have You Lost Your Mind Yet? When I wrote that album and I went to conceptualize what the album was going to be, I wrote it about mental health. Wow. And the album was about, how do you, Lily, how does my bass player, how do all these people I'm rolling with, what's our state in this mental health crisis as we're living in this era of information or misinformation, whatever you want to call it. And you get on the internet and it's like, holy fuck. Like you're on the internet and it's like this place where all this information is coming at you, information.
Right.
And somehow we're supposed to process that and still be normal people. Well, I was saying when I was writing the album that this is very abnormal and that most of us are walking around undiagnosed with some form of mental illness. From daily, my keyboard player, my bass player, listen, you got to go. And you got to watch on the news, this state-sponsored agency we call the police. Mm-hmm. And you know, they're arbitrarily executing, you know, African-American people. So we keep taking this in, and we're taking it in every day, and then it's become as normal as Starbucks. And then we that's issue one. Issue two is then just violence. In America, it's synonymous with, hey, maybe someone may walk in here and just decide to shoot up people like they did at Sandy Hook, which we don't even talk about Sandy Hook anymore. These were little kids.
Right.
You know what I mean? So the album was basically about how are we dealing with that? Hey man, people may just shoot up 56 people here, 22 over here. They go into a church, 11 here, but still we're like, cool. Let me see how many likes I got. You know, that's like our next line of questioning. And in that system of how do we value ourselves and what are our values are based on how many followers. My 11-year-old goes, hey, check this video out, Dad. It has 10 million likes. And I always tell him, like, what does that mean?
No, I really appreciate you speaking to that. One of the recent episodes I just did was with six of my friends. Like, it was like a youth panel talking about, you know, how people our age navigate mental health and navigate the world right now. And one of the main things that we talked about was that total desensitization in like the world that we're living in right now, in that age of overwhelm, is, you know, like, how do we deal with all with that constant influx of information, and how do we take care of our mental health when we're constantly seeing tragedy, when we're constantly, you know, being overwhelmed by bad news, horrible, yeah, horrible news. So, I mean, you said you wrote that album about it and how you deal with it. How do you think you deal with it?
Well, I want to say this too, and I want to be specific, because yeah, I think my two previous albums, you know, extremely macro. This was micro. This was like, I wanted to, when you say, how do I deal with it? I like that, because I'm like, hey, how am I going to deal with everything, and especially my mental health, which is my mental wealth, I call it, is I can really affect the things that happen on a micro level. Right. The things that happen on a micro level, we all have access to those things, because why? They're right in front of us. How do we treat people? Somebody calls you an asshole. Somebody calls you this. Somebody drops the N-bomb on me. You know, I mean, that happened to me. And I remember just looking at the person like, cool. Like, all right, fine. Like, I mean, like, not like, that's my war back on this micro level. Is I don't have to let that determine me, who I am.
Right.
Because I look around and I don't feel like that. I don't look in the mirror like, oh, you know, that's not me. So how do I deal with it? I dealt with it by looking at all my friends, taking each song off the record, and secretly, this is in secret, so I'm divulging this now, I wrote every song about every person that was around me. That, wow. And I was, the story was, how are they coping with this mental health challenge? There's a song on the record called King Frustration, and I wrote that about my cousin, because I'm right here in West Oakland, and she has been a lifelong drug addict, a prostitute that's a drug addict. So I just saw her walking, like doing her movement, and I just was like, man, I could just feel the baseline based on her movement. And I was like, that's it. I remember rushing home like, and I was like, her movement is worth more than any words. So again, the album is about the mental health of real people. It's about friends. It was hard to write that album, but it was explosive in that room, extremely cathartic. You had that feeling of like, it was a feeling of like healing and accountability. Wow. Healing and accountability, and they were meeting up, and that's weird. Healing doesn't always like accountability. Healing likes blame.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And accountability is lonely. It's like, hey, I'm trying to just be accountable over here, and there's no one in this line. I'm looking behind me, there's no one here. I'm trying to be accountable, and people are like, boo, accountability sucks. We like blaming Lily, you know, we like blaming Adu.
Yeah, and I think, that idea of, I think healing and accountability kind of have to go hand in hand in order for it to be real healing.
Which I love you. I love you for that. I keep saying that to people. And, you know, and listen, hey, that's going to get you onto a road you may not like either, because we can, Lily, we agree on that, right? So now let's take that equation and try to apply it to all the problems that are happening right now today, and see how many people shout you down.
Totally.
See how many people won't be with you. Because as you said, and I said, if you want it to be real, they go hand in hand. And that's going to go for Black Lives Matter. That's going to go for whoever's life matters. That's going to go for social justice, racial justice. That's going to go for inequity in how we distribute finances. That's going to go with, hey, why do we celebrate billionaires? Why? In my life, I see more billionaires equals more homeless people. Like, I grew up at a time, I didn't see that many homeless people. Now the tennis courts we used to play on in Oakland, those are all, that's a homeless encampment.
Yeah.
And right down the street in San Pablo Avenue, where I grew up, that's a homeless encampment now. So, you know, that accountability, you know, has to, I mean, we still keep making Amazon rich. Why?
Right.
What do we love about that? Like, what we complain, like, oh my God, this is terrible. We complain like Trump, and we complain all these things, but we seem really complicit also in enabling that machine, that monster to exist.
Totally. I think that that idea of blame, like always, I always think about like the narcissists in my life in terms of like wanting, you know, wanting to place the blame somewhere else and it being difficult to take accountability. And something that you've said is that you're a recovering narcissist and curious about like what did that look like before and what does that look like now for you to be like in recovery?
To me, Lily, I was, you know, at a young age, in my 20s, I was signed to this massive record deal, and I thought, I've made it. I want to be famous. You know, I want the best women, the best drugs, the best house, the best cars. Yes, number one, me. So I lived right. my life like that until one day, I'm in Los Angeles, I'm coming down the street, bam, I wake up with a beard, and 3 weeks have passed. And for all your viewers out here, this is what's left of my hand. My playing hand. A lot of people don't know this story.
Oh my God.
But I was never able to move my hand again. And, you know, my nails were really long and I had this beard. Like, what happened? Well, I remember waking up and for the first time in my life, I was just like, you know what? Maybe it's not the record company. Like, maybe it's not this person. Maybe it's not that person. I had all those, that time, you know, after waking up from 3 weeks in a coma, there's a lot of recovery time. And I really started to look at myself and a lot of my actions and a lot of my choices. And the first time I discovered that my choices were landing me in the positions that I was finding myself and that my mouth was getting me basically where I wanted to be. And that was like my recovery. I remember that day, my life changed. I didn't know if I'm ever gonna be able to walk again, speak clearly again, even use my hands, which, you know, I found a way, but that it looked like before this. Every day, I lived for me. Every day it was about me. Every day it was my birthday. When I wanted to be a musician, it was about me. Like I said, the best of this, the best of this. Man, what car do I have? I want to be a famous star and I want to write these songs. I want hits. Well, that's what it was before. And then I think we go years later, and I decided 5 years ago as a middle-aged guy to go play on the streets, and I became Fantastic Negrito. That guy was a recovering narcissist, and he was about, I don't care about fame. I don't care about cars and material things. I just care about connecting, man. I need that connectivity. I need to live for other people. So if I'm going to live for other people, I need to get out into the streets and play.
Right.
And people were like, wait a minute, you're a middle-aged guy? You got a funny haircut. you dress like some weirdo. And then they'd be like, your music's, these are industry people.
Right.
Your music is genre non-specific. How dare you?
You can have music that's like you can't, music industry people.
Yeah. Like, no. So they're like,
in a genre. No.
Yeah. So that's what happened. And, but the recovering narcissist was like, I don't care. I'm doing this for something much bigger. I'm actually doing it for my kids. Hey, every song I've ever written as Fantastic Negrito, I wrote for my kids. As a map, if something happened to me, they could go back and they could look at that, what dad wrote. And I'm really writing to them. They'll get older now and realize that, and maybe they'll be embarrassed or whatever. But I got to say that that's why I went out as a middle-aged guy. And the real people noticed me, like Chris Cornell. When I went to England, people like Robert Plant or people like Taj Mahal, or people like Buddy Guy, you know, these were the people that were like, no, this is great, man.
Right.
Keep doing what you're doing. So that's what it looked like. One guy wanted everything. One guy lived for himself. And the recovering narcissist lives for other people. And he's really happy contributing. And he really doesn't want much. He just wants to get up there and contribute the song.
That's beautiful. And honestly, aligns very directly with like the one major piece of advice that my dad gave me over and over and over again in my life was don't do anything with the intention or the goal of success. Like do things because you love to do it. And if success, and he would say, you know, like success came for me and that was great, but I didn't play music because I wanted, you know, the best of everything. I played it because I loved it. And that's why success came to me. So it seems like you're living that right now.
You know, I was a dude like coming from Oakland, I didn't really listen to rock and big hair bands, but I remember amongst all my peers, even in LA, we were just like, and in Oakland, we're like, man, here are these white boys in Seattle. Like, man, what are they doing? This is kind of cool. Like, everybody was coming, Nirvana, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, all these.
Right.
I remember like playing Death Certificate, which is an Ice Cube album.
Uh-huh.
And maybe, you know, it was a Seattle tape too. These are cassettes. I remember having that music. I remember I made The Last Days of Oakland. I had no record deal, man. I got nominated for a Grammy. I'm like, what? I'm walking in there, I'm looking around, they're like, hey, man, what record label are you with? And I was like,
yeah,
I don't have a record label. It's just me and my friends, you know?
Right, right.
And I believe I'm the first artist to, that narcissist is showing up. Back, narcissist. I'd be like, I was the first. See, I got to stop that. All right, so. But anyway, yeah, so I remember I made that record, Grammys, Hope, man, crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And then I made the next record, Please Don't Be Dead. And I remember I was like, hey, I took that Grammy and I just put it away. I don't have nothing to do with it because I'd be sitting there, Lily, and I'd be like writing and I would turn and I'd be like, and I just kept looking at that Grammy and I was like, damn it. I was like, are these Grammy chords?
Right.
It was just like some kind of weird evil. Look, no offense. I love winning Grammys.
Yeah, I totally get that.
No offense to the Grammy community. Keep giving me Grammys, but I gotta, hey, Lily, I got to put that shit away because it's something very weird about it. So I remember making that record, Please Don't Be Dead, and people were like, oh my God, like calling me up like, man, what are you doing? Like, you want a Grammy, man? Like, you're supposed to sound like The Last Days of Oakland like this. I remember someone's like, is this a rock record? Like all this, this fear. And I was just like, get away. I don't need, no, leave me alone. Because I didn't become an artist, especially at my age now. I mean, the don't give a fuck meter is like, phew.
Right.
I can't. So it's so imperative as artists, as the artists and creative community, that we really cling to that notion, that we really embrace the don't give a fuck meter. That because I think that's where amazing art come from. And myself, you know, being a Black person, an African-American person, I'm very aware that I come from a tradition of human expression in order to survive. Because coming from that trauma and that transatlantic slave trade, that's what I call what I do, Black roots music. I know that tradition was those hand claps and those hums, and that we had to survive that. And that is incredible that this music came out of it, rock and roll, soul, blues, funk, hip hop, jazz, electronic, house music, all this stuff came out of that. And so I'm always really trying to embrace that feeling, that sense of urgency.
Totally. No, and you touched on something I was going to ask you anyway. I mean, with everything going on in terms of, you know, systemic racism coming to light and police brutality coming to light, which has always been a thing, but now it seems like everyone's talking about it, which is, you know, as it should be. People should be talking about it. If you felt like intergenerational trauma has played a role in your mental health and like witnessing the things we're witnessing now, like what that trauma has done to your mental health and how you're coping with it?
That's a very, very, very good question. And I want to thank you for asking it, because I did a song once I did a song once and you know, and it was called The Suit That Won't Come Off. I want you to think about that. The suit that won't come off. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell you, white people whom I love dearly, and we're only 13% of the population. So we need white people to be on our side. We're only 13%.
Right.
Can't never explain to you, like probably you can't explain to me what it's like to be a woman. I'll never get it. I can't explain to you what this suit feels like, where every day it's there. Every day you deal with systemic racism. You need tools. The one good thing my abusive immigrant daddy was also brilliant did, he gave me tools. Mm-hmm. I didn't know he was giving them to me, but he was like, if the police stop you, they will blow your head off. They will blow your head off, in his accent. Mm-hmm. He kept going. I'm just like, oh my God. They will beat your brains out. That's how he talked.
Yeah.
So I remember all these things he drilled into my head. And then when I was 14, and a policeman pulled a gun on me on a 14-year-old. And I was like, wow, this is weird. This police seems afraid of me. And I'm looking around like, right. He seems terrified of me.
Right.
Do you have a gun? Do you have this? No, I don't have a gun. I have a water gun. I'm 14. But
right.
It clicked. And I had the tools to deal with that systemic racism that you're talking about. And I feel like that drives me batshit crazy, that that's the accountability that we need to come with our community. We need to make sure we have the tools to deal with this systemic racism, because it ain't going nowhere. And arguing with a police officer ain't going to help our cause. You know, we need to get their badge numbers and deal with them with lawyers.
Right.
You know, so I want to say that first, just as an elder, I'm a 52-year-old dude. I want to say that that's what I want to try to impart on younger people, is that we need tools to deal with racism. It ain't going nowhere. Mm-hmm. When the police stop you, you're a black man, you're not a pretty white girl. Let me say that again. Look in the mirror. It's not going to happen. You're not going to be treated equally. But I always tell my historian PhD brother, we talk and we argue, and I go, listen, man. And he goes, man, you oversimplify things, but I want you to listen to this. White people, from the day one, when we started transatlantic slavery, they cut you out of the deal. Because white landowners, they were like 0.5%. They opened up a factory in your neighborhood. Let's take that in. When you open a factory in someone's neighborhood, people are happy. Why? Because there's a factory, they're going to get jobs. Mm-hmm. Those jobs are going to have benefits. Those jobs are going to empower their community. So a small percentage of rich white male, they're a very small percentage of landowners, moved their cotton tobacco companies into neighborhoods with a factory. And they didn't offer jobs because they sold white supremacy. They're like, hey, we can't give you jobs picking cotton. Sorry, we're millionaires. We got people from Africa that are going to do it free. But check it out. At least you're not those animals. You're not. They're animals. You're white. Holy shit. White people need to think about that. They fooled poor white people on day one.
Right.
They should have been like, oh, turn that ship around. Sorry.
Right.
For all the racist people who say go back to Africa, they're
late. I was going to say. I mean, they now this is
then it then.
Yeah.
They should have said then it then and be like, sorry, you rich white people. You want to have cotton? We need jobs.
Right.
We need unions. We'll pick cotton, not from sunup to sundown. And no, you can't sell my kids. I will pick cotton from 9 to 5. I will have medical benefits. You know what I mean? Oh. Then you have something.
Right.
When I think of white supremacy and the construct of racism, the victims, and I'm sure a lot of my stuff is controversial to people, the greatest victims of white supremacy are white people. They don't understand that this wealth that was created by a small group of people, it's not for them.
Totally.
That the good schools, they're not for you. That the good diets and the good food, it's not for you. I've traveled these states in the South. People are suffering, poor white people, they tend to be like obese. Poor white people tend to be in marginalized communities that don't offer education, and they tend to be real racist. Think about all that stuff. And they tend to be supporters of very wealthy white politicians.
Right.
And your nervous system is frayed, and you've been dealing with this your whole life. But then, you know, you got to say to yourself too, like, hey, man, I deal with it like this. Hey, I ain't no victim. Sorry. I don't need anybody. I don't need a slogan. I don't need a sign to tell me my life matters. I already know my life matters. So there's also something going on with our white brothers and sisters that mentally that needs to be addressed. Because if we address that, then all this stuff is going to go away. Because then people will realize that they've been fooled for all these years.
As you know, as I've learned about politics, that one of like Trump's main tactics is obviously, I don't know how he did this, but convinced like the poor white population that they have the same you know, best interest as like the 1%, and that those Venn diagrams are two different circles. Like the best interest in those two populations are not at all the same.
And that's, really, you're saying exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Yeah. In a way, because he can do it because they've been doing that to poor white people since the beginning.
Right.
Why would a poor white person like a rich landowner that grows tobacco and cotton and has people from another continent working free? Why would they like that person? I would hate that person. And it doesn't benefit white people. Mm-hmm. And when they wake up from that, which I feel like is a mental health crisis.
Yeah.
Then we can start getting some things done. Then we can have healing and accountability.
Right. Do you talk to your kids about it?
Oh, absolutely, man. All the time. That's what and I share it with my nephews. And even on the last days of Oakland, I have a skit called What Would You Do? What Do You Do? And that whole skit, if people want to go back, it's an interlude. It's about what do you do if the police stop you? I put it on a record. Like I said, why? Because I put it for my kids. And that's my responsibility to say these things. And again, people may disagree with me because I'm not looking for like a victim. I'm not going to be a victim. I'm not looking for someone who can blame. I'm not doing that because I know it doesn't work.
Right.
Lily, it doesn't work. If it worked, I'd be like, let's do that shit. That shit works, but it doesn't work.
Yeah. Thank you so much for speaking to that so openly. You know, it's obviously, I think, you know, if anything has come out of this time, being able to have these conversations and like facilitating them is something that's so, so, so important.
I'm sorry. I'm probably, what happens when you're the eighth of 14 kids, you talk a lot.
No. This is what this is for. You get to
otherwise I wouldn't have eaten. I wouldn't get socks. I wouldn't get underwear. Nothing. It's like, it's hell being eighth of 14.
I wanted to ask, because something that obviously like my dad struggled with was self-medication. And even when he was like, you know, in the height of his music career and doing well, there was untreated mental health issues that he was treating himself with, things like drugs and alcohol. Is that something you ever struggled with?
You know what, man? I tell you, I grew up hustling, and I grew up in Oakland. And Oakland, it was like make the drugs and sell them.
Right.
And so it was a different culture that I was coming from. I was coming from poverty. I was coming from, like I said, man, my 14-year-old brother killed, my 16-year-old cousin killed, my best friend growing up killed. Man, I was going through like being in a war zone.
Right.
So for us, we were so poor and we didn't have nothing. Mm-hmm. And so it was about destroying your community. Let me just introduce that. So I'm guilty of that. Like I cooked up drugs and I sold them and I helped destroy my own community.
Right.
Because I felt like the American dream would only come to me if I had money, a really screwed up value system. So I didn't really struggle with using drugs. I struggled with narcissism and self-importance.
Right.
And I struggled with the mental illness of thinking that, if I have this car, then I'm okay.
Right.
That's very sick.
Right.
If I have X amount of dollars in the bank, yeah, then I'm good. Hey, well, it didn't help Michael Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't help Prince. It didn't help Kurt Cobain. It didn't help your dad. So there's a lot of lessons out there. Like, no, none of that shit is going to make you happy.
Right.
None of it is. What's going to make you happy is getting to know who you are and getting to accept that, you know what? Hey, when I wrote Have You Lost Your Mind Yet, this album, it was about this. Mm-hmm. You're feeling depressed? It's okay. I woke up this morning, I felt like shit. That's okay. Now we got somewhere to go. Let's put on some music. Let's feel better. Ooh, Stevie Wonder. Oh man, I feel good now. Yeah. You know, or it's okay. It's okay. We don't have to be perfect. Somebody sold you that lie that stuff, that fame, that money, that you were going to find happiness in that.
Mm-hmm.
No way. Mm-hmm. So I think I didn't become super famous when I was young. And I think it was because I got the record deal and all that, but it was to prepare me to be this guy.
Mm-hmm.
It makes me feel good. And again, it makes me feel very useful. And I'm fortunate that I didn't struggle with drugs and alcohol, but as I told you, I struggled with other things.
Right. Absolutely.
Which are just as damaging.
Totally. And a different form of self-medication.
Yep, exactly. Sure. A different form.
You were touring with my dad, and like, I, you know, that's how we crossed paths. Is mental health ever something that like you guys talked about? Cause I know he, you know, being on the road, like for all musicians is a very different, like your mental health looks very different when you're living on a tour schedule, which can be super difficult.
One of the most things that poignant things that stays in my head that your dad said to me, we're backstage, maybe it was Italy, I've forgotten. He was like, you know what? He goes, I still to this day can't believe that, you know, Kurt did that. Kurt was my friend. And I just can't believe that to this day, it's still a shock that that happened.
Right.
I remember that moment that Chris and I shared talking about that. And, you know, then when I got the news of your dad, I was just like, thought of that moment that we had that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we talked about, you know, getting up there and having to do it every night. And, you know, what that people expecting you, people pushing you out there. Hey, go,
right. Go
do it. Because a lot of people are making money.
Right.
He was like a big brother in the sense he was really proud of everything I was accomplishing. Because he was like, I told these people, he goes, man, I'm right. You know, this guy's, right. You know, when I won the Grammy, no one was more excited
than
him. I remember he tweeted like, sometimes they get it right, bro. Sometimes they get it right. He's like, they don't always get it right. But he was, because I kind of find like, I felt like NPR and then Chris Cornell were kind of the people that kind of pushed me onto the world. When I met Chris, he was like, it was in Norway. And I thought, this dude's crazy. Like, what do you, your fans are going to hate me. Like, we're so different. He was like, no. He's like, man, I'm so excited, man. Go out there, man, and play. And he's like sitting there at the side of the stage watching me. And I was like in Norway. And it's like 2,000 Norwegians sitting there.
Oh, my God.
Very stoically. And I was like, I'm used to like action, the funky front man. So I kind of had to learn from Chris Cornell the first couple shows. I honestly tell people, like, how do you stand there and command people with a guitar? So I was like studying him. Like, and so I took like what he did and just did it kind of my way. So
beautiful.
But I remember you the first time meeting you after a show. And you were like real excited about my show. And I thought, wow, she's young to be excited. I was surprised, like you understood the energy of my.
Right.
And I thought, like, she's kind of advanced. You were like, you had to be like 15 or something like that. I can't remember.
Yeah, I think so.
I was like, but I can tell when people really have, because I call my show Church Without the Religion. It's church without. So I always can tell when people have felt my message. And it was like on your face. And I'm like, oh, this is cool. She's young. The youngster. Oh, I had a guitar, a song, you know, I did one of the songs that I played every night while touring with your dad was my rendition of In the Pines.
Mm.
And I took that and I changed a lot of lyrics to honor the strongest people in the community that I grew up in, and that was women that had to bury their own children.
Mm.
And I'm proud to announce that guitar has now been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and it's on display.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
Yeah, so I'm right next to Tom Morello's shirt. I have his shirt and my guitar for In the Pines. Those are my talking points.
Cool.
There they go, that quick, I'm done.
No, that's amazing. That's amazing, thank you. And honestly, like, yeah, so deserved and so happy that you're able to receive that, you know, receive the success and receive the beauty of it in a way that feels meaningful and not in a way where it's, you know, like you're just wanting more and more and more.
I'm always surprised. I'm like, oh, cool. Wow.
Right.
Great.
Right.
I go back home to my kids and my dog and none of them care. So it's great.
Right.
Yes. I love
exactly.
That.
The last question that I like to ask everybody at the end of each interview is what is something that's giving you hope right now?
Oh, see, I thought you were going to say something like Fruit Loops or Tricks. None of them. Anyway. Oh man, that's a beautiful question. You ask good questions. What gives me hope is that I can breathe. What gives me hope is that like I can see. What gives me hope is that I can hear. What gives me hope is, you know, we have an opportunity every day when we have obstacles and we have challenges, but they're opportunities for amazing things to happen right now. Pandemic, racial strife, Trump, Biden, neo-fascism is a great opportunity to make a connection, a great opportunity to reach out to someone, a great opportunity to collaborate. It's a great opportunity to forgive someone. It's a great opportunity to reach across, you know, the street to the neighbor you've hated for 10 years and make up with them. We have so many opportunities, and that is what gives me hope, is that we can practice this religion of gratitude, man. And if we can do that, it just leaves no room for the bullshit, the negativity, and all the horrible stuff. And you know, making albums gives me hope because I'm able to communicate with people on a very primal level. And nothing makes me happier when someone sends me an email like, you know, my mom was passing away and, you know, we played your record and, you know, she went out to your record. Or, you know, hey, I'm a Black kid and I'm different, man. And I see that you're different and it's okay to be different, man. Thank you. And here's my album I'm working on. And, you know, that gives me hope, man. I see hope. I'm positive. I don't look out and see, like what I said, like, you know, I don't wake up every day to racism, go, oh my God, what can I do? Oh shit. Like,
right.
I don't look at it that way. I look at it as like, okay, that's someone else's problem. Let's create some music. Bring me those hand claps. Bring me them organs. Bring me that bass. And I see hope and positivity everywhere. Look what you're doing with your show. That gives me hope. Hope is all around me.
Thank you so much for being here, Xavier. It was so such a joy to see your face and get to catch up and, you know, talk about how much different the world is right now compared to the last time we saw each other.
Well, thank you for, you know, giving me the platform, and thank you for using your voice. And you, I'm really proud of you. And man, I know your dad would be so proud of you right now with what you're doing.
That means the world to me. That means the world to me. And having your voice on this series makes it that much more special, truly. And you know, having that connection too with my dad is super special.
Well, thank you, Lily. And I'll see you in Paris. This time, lunch is on you.